Depending on how we view it, this could be seen either as the final panel session or the penultimate session before the concluding session. Whichever way we look at it, I think this is a very important session because of the colorful lineup of scholars who have been involved in looking at the problem of decolonization of knowledge or its related concept of multi-diversity for a long time. And they will be addressing many of the core issues which have already been raised over the last 2-3 days. And in that sense, this is going to be a very important session. On another note, I think all of us kept hearing in the last session that they were 17 minutes late. But if you look at the time right now, for being 17 minutes late, they were compensated by almost 1 hour. It went on. In Japan, I'm sure many of you are familiar with this or have heard this, if a train runs more than 10 minutes late, the station master and all the senior staff will line up to apologize to the passengers for the breach of contract. They are supposed to. But I think in our case, and this is where context is very important, in our case, I think you were rewarded for being late, in the sense that because you ran, 17 minutes late or so, you had more time for discussion. You had more time, I think, to enjoy and to reflect on the views of the speakers as well as the other participants. I'm not going to stand up to apologize on behalf of anybody because the context is different. Here, it's a good thing that the organizers were generous with time. We are fortunate to have 4 key papers and a commentator who will be responding to the presentations. And as I said, these 4 presentations represent an effort to look into specific situations which focus essentially on the university. So there is a kind of difference if you look at the earlier sessions and this session. And perhaps for that reason, it's a befitting final panel because our focus, the theme of the conference, is decolonizing our universities. So at the end of the day, although we had the liberty to venture into all kinds of other related issues, we have to fall back on the main purpose of this assembly. I am tempted to offer my own reflections on the theme of the conference, but I shall refrain from that in view of the limitations of time. And we are also doubly fortunate because all the speakers have agreed to make their presentation, which are already in a sense made available to all of you in the conference package, within a time frame of about 15 minutes. And then we'll go on to the commentary and open the session for discussion. The first speaker is Yusef Progler, someone who has been associated with the Multiversity project for quite some time, one of the initiators, and therefore somebody who is well informed in the development and the history of this initiative to bring about a rethinking, reframing of the priorities of our universities. Actually, his bio data, very impressive bio data, is also available in the conference package. You can have a look at that. But I just would like to highlight one of or two points, apart from the earlier suggestion that he has been one of the original members of the initiative. At present, Professor Progler teaches at a university in Japan, the Asia Pacific Ritsumeikan University, and the university itself is a model of an attempt to bring about a new way of looking at higher education, especially university education in Japan, because this is a university which accommodates both languages, English as well as Japanese, and which has almost the same number in terms of composition of Japanese and non-Japanese, allowing for some experimentation to take place. How would a truly international community relate to each other in a university setting compared to perhaps the 1,000 or so other universities in Japan, which tend to be wholly Japanese in outlook, orientation, and direction. Without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Progler. By the way, all the speakers will be making their presentations from here. They have chosen to do it from here rather than to walk up to the rostrum.
Thanks very much for the introduction. I'd like to mention three points in the limited time that I have here. One of them is a reflection on a personal question that several people have asked me here that I think is relevant to this meeting. The second point is I want to reflect on the idea of multiversity within the context of institutional changes that are happening in universities around the world. And then third, I would like to mention an initiative that we began last year that we entitled Multiversity Media and outline that briefly and invite you to participate in that. The question that people asked in various ways of me here, let me repeat one of those questions. Someone said, how do you feel as an American about all this West bashing, American bashing, and how did you get involved in such a thing? Well, I thought about that, actually, and I think that type of where we come from question is important for me to reflect on, but also for all of us to think about. When I was a university student, I was in university primarily for the reason that many students come to university. today, many. That is to find a job and for lack of nothing better to do. But I didn't have any burning desire to study. It was just those two reasons. I think if we really are reflecting, we'll find that many of our students are like that. But something happened to me in that university experience, and that ignited my mind and led to 10 years of writing, really an impact, and something ignited in me. That 10 years of writing is what led to the invitation from Claude and Idris to join this project in the early, about 10 years ago from now. So what happened to me in the university? And that, I want to talk briefly about John Mohawk, who was one of my professors. He's a member of the Haudenosaunee Nation, one of the indigenous groups of people that live in what's now called the United States and Canada. He was a professor at the university that I was at, along with Oren Lyons and Audrey Shenandoah, other members of the indigenous peoples of Western New York and Southern Ontario. John did what we are saying needs to be done, many of the things. For example, he taught me an indigenous people's view of American history. And of course, it flew in the face of the official view of American history that is inculcated to school kids throughout their primary and secondary education. And that made a tremendous impact on me. And suddenly, I wanted to be there, not just for lack of something to do, not just to find a job, but it ignited my mind. The second point that he made is that before Europeans colonized the world, they colonized themselves. And that's a point that someone else brought up earlier in this conference as well. And that made a very big impact on me as well. And then also the way that he lived as a university professor was quite interesting to me. It didn't come through the normal training. One of the things that Ward Churchill mentions in the White Studies pamphlet that I edited is that we have to try to find ways to bring people into the academy that are not accredited according to the usual rules of the academy. And so he was among a number of native peoples that had other credentials, let's call them, besides the usual credentials that professors have, that they formulated this Native Studies program as part of what's called the American Studies program. John was an organic farmer. He lived on the reservation, and he had a very strong participation in local activities around organic farming, but he also was intensely involved in global work. This is the mid-90s when the internet was still quite young. Most people didn't even know what it was, but he was all over the internet, and he was among the people that helped the Zapatistas movement to counter the Mexican government. Of course, a lot of the organizing that brought global support for the Zapatistas movement in Chiapas was organized via the internet. And John was all over that. So he had a global dimension. He also was a dynamic speaker at many of the anti-globalization rallies that were being held around the US at that time. And so he had a global dimension that involved internet and things of that sort, but he also was firmly rooted in a locale of some sort as an organic farmer. This being around this person ignited me from just another student shuffling through the halls of higher education into someone who became on fire, really, with ideas. And I spent the next 10 years writing anything that I could. And that is what led to the invitation to join this project. There's a sad end to that story, which is relevant to the next thing that I want to talk about here, and that is a couple of years after I graduated, the American Studies Department was essentially decimated by the university. It consisted of Native American Studies, African American Studies, Puerto Rican Studies, Women's Studies, Working Class Studies, all as a kind of a coalition creating this Department of American Studies. It's not the Yale model, the patriotic Yale model of American Studies. This is the, let's call it the subaltern American Studies. But it was, the department was decimated by the new neoliberal ideology that had infected many of the administrators of the university. One of the inspiring forces behind that was the books of Martha Nussbaum and a number of other people that were raising questions that were raised earlier about relevance and accountability of university programs, and they started turning things over to the accountants rather than to the academics, and so it became a numbers game, and there was a wave of attempts, and many successful, to try to shut down various kinds of studies programs. CUNY suffered some of that as well in New York City. The American Studies faculty was unable to rise to that challenge. They either were unwilling to have that discussion to defend on the same turf as the Martha Nussbaums of the world and the other people, or they were unwilling to mount a response or unable. But whatever happened, that department basically was decimated, and the faculty were spread among other, back retreated back to ordinary disciplines. It can no longer grant PhDs, and it became seriously downsized. Well, this trend of the financial questions becoming part of what we have to face in university is only increased since then. But it isn't new. I mean, the name Multiversity, in fact, there's an irony about our name. There are actually two multiversities, and I'd like to spend a few minutes reflecting on the two multiversities. The first time the term was used was by Clark Kerr, the president of University of California in the early 1960s, that proposed the idea in a book called The Uses of the University. He proposed the idea of multiversity as an institution that is accountable to society in various ways. Of course, the cryptic message behind him, as interpreted by many of the academics that seriously resisted that, was that the society, to Clark Kerr, meant corporations and other moneyed interests. But this question of who is the university is accountable to is an interesting question. And so I think we need to keep that in mind, not that it's accountable to corporations and the government and whatever as a kind of a clearinghouse for the needs of the powerful in the society, but there is a question of accountability and relevance that we can broaden beyond that original idea of the multiversity. Now, our idea of the multiversity, which arose about 10 years ago, is about curriculum, rebalancing the discrimination, the Eurocentrism, and it's also really about accountability to the past, to ourselves, to our communities. It's also about relevance. How is what we study relevant to us and the world? So although, you know, I don't want to put those two together to say they're saying the same thing, they are in many ways, from a different perspective, raising an important point here. And this has only gotten more acute with the ascendancy of the neoliberal ideology that is really now turning a lot of what happens in universities over to the accountants. Subsidies from governments are drying up the world over. I made it a point to talk to many of you here to see if it's happening in your places, and indeed they said yes. Universities are shifting from elite national institutions into more of a corporate model, a business model. There are serious implications for this. One of the implications is around the funding issues, is the question of, one way to solve that is to downsize the university, raise the tuition, make the entrance requirements more stringent. People are protesting in the UK and other places for that. That would basically be turning it over to the rich and to those who are already predisposed towards intellectual endeavors. Unlike me, when I went into the university, I think I was probably part of a majority of students that were not part of either of those categories. Not the sons and daughters of the intellectuals, for example, not the sons and daughters of the rich, just somebody that sees the university as a way of upward mobility to get a job and something to do for lack of nothing better to do. Now, I think if we close out those students by following the one proposal to address this question is to downsize the university, make limitations, raise the tuition, we're doing, in my opinion, a serious injustice. But the other side of it is that there are financial issues that if they're not met, then the universities will close, as we mentioned in some of our papers, they'll go bankrupt. And the end result is the same, except instead of turning it over to the rich and intellectuals, we'll turn it over to nobody. So if we look at the opposite perspective, we could think about opening the doors of the university to everybody. That could solve the financial problem, but it would mean serious adjustments of our expectations of what we think we ought to be doing as university professors. The idea of training the next generation of ourselves, that is, of researchers, would not work in that model. We would have to think seriously about larger class sizes and things of that sort. Now, I'm not going to take sides on this. I just want to put that out there as a structural, institutional, administrative dynamic that is impacting many of us. It could be that the, let's call the research elite that would rather have a few highly motivated, intelligent, well-read students to teach could eventually collude with the accountants to lead to the closing or downsizing of significant numbers of universities the world over. That would leave us then with the question of what do we do with all of the, what I termed in an earlier lecture, the potential walking wounded, people that have spent their entire youth, really, in high school, looking towards the university and then finding that the door is being slammed shut in their face. By the way, something that's missing from all of our discussions here is that phenomenon of that really the university has colonized secondary and primary school. The main purposes of that type of schooling has been to get into universities, but it's only a small percentage that can get in many places, and of those, upon graduation, they don't get what they expect to get, which is a job or some position in society. So we have to think about these issues, but we might face the possibility that who we see as students now, let's call them learners, there might be many, 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 many more of those outside the academy than inside. And so I think we have to also play a role in that body of learners as well. And so there are two ways I can envision to do that. One is, of course, community, on the community level, on the local level, that maybe you don't need school, maybe you don't need university. If you have something that's vibrant in the community that students can walk into, then you wouldn't have to go to university to get a job. You wouldn't have to go to university for lack of nothing better to do. But that's something that there are myriad examples now of these local initiatives. So I'm not going to talk about that. I want to talk about the global side of this. And just briefly mention the Multiversity Media Project that we've been working on. The main idea here is to take advantage of the internet as a way to distribute our work and the work of others, to make that readily available to anyone who wants to learn any of the things that we have to say. The internet now has reached the stage where it really can, I think, be accessible to ever-increasing numbers of people. So we have to take steps. The internet is not something that's there, right? It's something that is made by people. And much of the internet now is incestuous, that is cutting and pasting from one site to another, and much of the internet is presentist, that is, it's current events and things that are happening now. But there's a whole another body of knowledge and information and experience that is not part of the incestuous and presentist internet that we have to participate in adding those things to the internet. Things don't get on the internet by themselves. So we have to open up file sharing sites, discussion forums, blogs, make servers available, internet television channels that can spread the kinds of things that we think are relevant and important to our message so that whether somebody is inside a university or outside of a university, they have access to that knowledge. Printing books and journals is one thing, but it's very expensive to ship and carry these heavy things. We ought to be scanning, making PDFs of all of our books, all of our articles, and put those readily and freely available on the internet. Any documentary films and other creative works of digital media that we are involved in, we should put those up and make those readily and freely available. to anyone who wants to watch them. And we can organize all of this through a series of discussion forums, web blogs, servers that would store this. And I outlined in great detail how that type of system might work in my earlier paper, which is also on the multi-world site, so I'm not going to go into the details of that. But just to mention before I finish that what has happened since we launched this last year, there are three channels on the internet. One is TVU Networks. We've got about 50,000 viewers on that and about 400 programs that are airing in a rotation on that. That runs like a conventional television station. It's there. It runs according to a schedule. You turn it on, you watch what's on or not. Then there is a YouTube channel and a Vimeo channel. Those are more on demand. We put stuff on those channels. People click and they watch when they want to watch it. And those are three separate different kinds of entities. We have to put all of our materials on those. But eventually we need to detach ourselves from those and set up our own servers, our own places to do this. But for now, we can use what's available. And on the YouTube channel, we've got about 150,000 viewers and about 200 videos on there. And on Vimeo, which is a newer one, there are about 3,000 or 4,000 viewers with about 40 videos. And so I invite you to read my paper from last year called Toward Multiversity Media that outlines all these details. And you ought to be visiting and giving some feedback on these. And we need other people who can participate in this, because you can't do it all with one person. What we really need is a core of technically savvy people that want to build this type of a network so that we can make our knowledge and our information available on a global scale. Thanks very much. Look forward to discussions later.
Thank you very much.